Good morning. Happy Easter to you and your family. If we have a lot of visitors here today. My name is Patrick Kelly. I'm the associate pastor here. We are so glad that you are here with us. What a great song. I love it when they stop and everybody claps and then they keep going. Isn't that funny how they do that? Yeah, it's funny. I told the guy I was sitting next to, I'm supposed to speak, and luckily I played in the orchestra one time when they did this, so I knew they start again. I didn't get up at the wrong time. As the choir is coming out, what greater way for us to start the service on Resurrection Sunday than a baptism? We're going to have a baptism. So as Danny gets into place, just a reminder for you and me. Do you remember when you were baptized? Do you remember when you asked Jesus into your heart? Remember that day? A special day for my friend Bradley.
Cell phone fell out and it's in my boot right now. So if you see sparks and you think I'm speaking in tongues, you'll know what's going on if these waiters start leaking, but that's not going to happen. We do have one that's come forward, Bradley Terry. Bradley just came forward last week saying he's accepted Jesus as his Lord and Savior and wants to live for him. And I know he's got family and here. If you would love to stand in his honor and welcome him into the family, would you do so now? Bradley, have you asked Jesus Christ in your heart as Lord and Savior? Yes. But upon your open and public profession of Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, I baptize you, my brother, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We're buried with Christ in baptism and raised to walk in a new life. Woo! Thank you. Just to let you know, there's nothing magical about this water. It's just typical Haltom City, Fort Worth water. But what we do in baptism, it's a representation of what Christ is doing in your life. Just as Jesus Christ rose from the grave, when we enter into a relationship with him, we basically rise again, and that's what that symbolizes. So just ask yourself, if you have not been baptized, please come forward during our welcome, our invitation time. I would love to talk with you about that. Patrick?
What a great way to start our Resurrection Sunday. Congratulations to Bradley, the beginning of a walk that lasts for eternity. And many of us have already begun that. When we come to church, we have the opportunity to have visitors. If you're visiting with us today, some of you, I've looked around the crowd, you're like, he knows me. You've come to be with family, and we know that you attend another church, but you're here to be with family. We're so glad that you're here today. Make sure you come by and shake my hand. It'll be your privilege. I'm sorry, I said that wrong. No, there's a lot of faces that I see. I'm so glad that you're here. But if you're visiting with us from our community, and you're coming in today, and it's like, I'm a visitor. We would love to know that you're here. In the pew in front of you, in a minute, the lights are going to come up. In the pew in front of you, you're going to find a visitor's card. If you'll just fill that out and put it in one of the wooden receptacles on the wall as you leave, we'd just love to know that you're here. If you have prayer requests for you or your family, our church would love to pray for you and get to know you. You may say, well, I live somewhere else, but I'm just visiting today. We'd just love to know that you're here. In this time in our service, we have our fellowship time. And so what's going to happen is the lights are going to come up here in a second. And you're going to be able to stand up, walk across the aisles, meet and greet one another, shake hands. At the very end of that, there's going to be a timer. And after the timer ends, there's going to be a video that you don't want to miss. So keep an eye on that while you shake hands with one another during our fellowship time. So we're going to begin that. As lights come up, we'll begin that now.
From in the beginning was the Word, to it is finished at the cross. That is Jesus. And this is Easter. Because of Jesus, the sting of death is gone. Hope is the hero now, and joy makes sorrow jealous. Because of Jesus, we are victors, overcomers, and more than conquerors. Guilt is gone, fear has fled. We are set free and made pure. United in cause, perfected in purpose, givers of good news, of grace and mercy. Because of Jesus, we are called children of God and the church on the rock. We are friends of Jesus and brothers and sisters in faith. Heaven is waiting, and we have assurance for our souls. His sacrifice justifies, his love sanctifies. The gift of eternal life is free in his name. Because of Jesus, there's peace in our hearts, pardon for our sins, and pouring out to our neighbors with radical generosity. Because of Jesus, everything has changed. We are changed from the inside out, and it's all because of Jesus. This is Easter.
Good morning. We are so thankful that you came to worship with us this morning. What a great way to start our service with a baptism. He is risen just as he said. Please stand with us and sing as we begin worship this morning.
Suffering, you saw to the other side, knowing. And so I'm going to be taking a look at John 20 and walking us through kind of this first resurrection encounter and doing it as a prayer exercise. So if you have your scriptures with you, we'll be in John chapter 20. We're going to be in verse 11. And this is how it reads. But Mary was standing outside the tomb weeping. And so as she wept, she stooped and looked into the tomb. And she saw, She saw two angels in white sitting, one at the head and one at the feet where the body of Jesus had been lying. And they said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" And she said to them, "Because they have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there and did not know that it was Jesus. And Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." And Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Hebrew, "Rabboni," which means teacher. And Jesus said to her, "Stop clinging to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. But go to my brethren and say to them, I have ascended to my Father and your Father, and my God and your God." Mary Magdalene came, announcing to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord," and that he had said these things to her. So our first prayer exercise together is to recognize that Mary was there expectantly. So if you would take a moment and kind of do some self-reflection and ask that the Lord would meet you here today with an expectant heart. Our text also shows that Mary was in a grieving process. She came to the tomb after a whirlwind of a weekend. So wherever you are this morning, we've been there before. So at this time, whatever you have that you've brought with you into this place, whatever burdens that you've been carrying, stresses that you have, now is the time to offer those at the feet of Jesus. As the text continues, we see that Jesus is not in the tomb, but he has risen. So for this portion of the reflection and the prayer, offer thanks that Jesus did not stay in that tomb, but that he rose in power. And finally, we see as the text ends that Mary is on a mission. She has met the risen Christ, and she is now ready to go and tell. So ask the Lord to give you someone to go and tell this good message that we have this morning. Father, we thank you so much for a chance to come together to worship in this place, the fact that our Savior did not stay in the tomb, but that he rose in power, that the mission has been accomplished, that all things have been fulfilled. And Father, we thank you that you've now given us this task of spreading this message. And so we pray for Danny as we get ready to hear this resurrection story preached and proclaimed. Father, we pray that if we ourselves are seeking, that we would meet the Savior this morning. And if we have met the Savior and we call him Lord and teacher, we pray that you would give us the encouragement and the task to go and share this good news with those that we come in contact with. We love you, we thank you, and we look forward to seeing and encountering your risen Son this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Trent. Thank you, worship team. Happy Resurrection Sunday. I know. He has risen. I know It being Easter, a lot of you put on your Easter clothes and maybe you wore your Easter hat and you came expecting to hear some great music and hear a great sermon about the resurrection, right? Bring it. You heard that challenge right there. To really understand the resurrection, it's like anything else. You really need to know the whole story. You really got to know the whole story to be able to put it in context, to really see the beauty of it. If I came out here and I just told you the ending of some movie, you may have seen the movie before, but you may have missed some parts. You don't get the whole thing, right? Let's say you started watching, there's a movie called Matrix Resurrection. Anybody see that? I haven't seen that one. I saw the first three. Okay, it's a trilogy. And I'm not going to go into the story. But if you were to go into the last 30 minutes of the third movie, and you say, okay, this is cool, great visual. I can see kind of what's going on. But it's so much better when you know the whole story, when you know it all, right? It puts it in context, and it makes it more real and more alive. And so that's what I want us to do this morning. I want us to look at the resurrection in the timeline of all of mankind's interaction with God, from creation to today. Now, I know some of you right now thinking, oh, right, he's going to preach through the whole Bible. And you're squirming in your seats. And you're thinking, I should have eaten another donut because now the Lutherans are going to beat us to Cracker Barrel. I promise it's not going to be that bad. To understand the resurrection, we want to look at it. And it's this central linchpin of Christianity in the scope of the whole story. Our men's Bible study, we just did a Bible study called 30 Days to Understanding the Bible. On a book by Max Anders. And it's about reading and knowing the whole story. Because sometimes we look at scriptures and we look at it very close and we see this one little part, but we don't see that part in the grand scheme. See, we know the stories, but we don't always understand and know the story. So that's what we're going to do this morning. How do we start that off? Okay, the story of God. Let's talk about that in the Old Testament, how God interacts with man. We have a world created, and then it's broken almost immediately. You know the story about creation. God spoke the world into existence, and he spoke it into existence, and he created man. And God and man had this perfect relationship. There was nothing in the way. They had direct communion. Adam had free food everywhere. He didn't have to work. The work that he did have was joyful. He was getting to walk around naked. It was just a very relaxing atmosphere because it was perfect. And then Adam, after Eve was created, Adam and Eve made a choice. They did the one thing that God said, don't do this. Don't eat of this tree. And they were tempted. What was the temptation? The serpent told them, if you eat of this tree, you're not going to die, God. That's not true. If you eat of it, you'll get to be like God. It's the same temptation for you and me every day, that you get to be the one that chooses what's right and wrong. You get to control everything. And so they did. And when that happened, there became this barrier between God and man. What was perfect was now broken, and mankind was separated. They didn't have the intimate walk anymore. There was separation because of a broken relationship. And mankind continued to spiral and go down. And you know some of the other stories. You know the one about the flood. And mankind had just gone so bad that God says, you know what? I'm going to have a do-over. And so he started over. He wiped out the entire planet except for Noah and his family and then a pair of all the animals. And so he kind of rebooted, and he made a promise. I'm not going to destroy the world again this way. But man went on his merry way, and you know many of the Old Testament stories, but God had a plan all along. He said, you know what, I'm going to fix this. I knew it was going to happen, but I had a plan in place. I'm going to create a nation of people who will represent me to all of mankind now and forever. And you know what? God chose. He didn't go look around and say, where are the cool people? Where are them Baptists at? Or where are them Texans at? You know, he didn't do anything like that. He said, I'm going to pick one guy. And he chose one man. His name was Abraham. Originally, it was Abram, and God changed his name. Abraham was an old man, and his wife was old. They were past childbearing years. And he calls Abraham, and he says, Abraham, guess what? I got some great news for you. And he made Abraham these promises. He said, I'm going to make your descendants like the stars in the sky, like the sand on the shore. I'm going to have all these descendants. I'm going to make your name great. I'm going to give you your own land that's going to be forever yours. And I'm going to bless the entire world through you, through one of your descendants. It's the first time we begin to hear about the coming Messiah, the anointed one. And God makes up. Now, he does have one little caveat. He says, oh, and by the way, your people, your descendants, are going to be captive in another land for about 400 years. I'm going to read that to you. Genesis 15, 13 and 14. Then the Lord said to Abram, "Know for certain that your offspring will be sojourners in a land that is not theirs and will be servants there. And they will be afflicted for 400 years. But I will bring judgment on the nation that they serve. And afterwards they shall come out with great possessions." And so the Jewish people, the Israelites, the Hebrews, they had a purpose. God had chosen them to represent him to all mankind, to be his ambassadors, to communicate his heart, his moral law, and all of these things they were supposed to represent. And so they would do that sometimes, and then they would fail sometimes. Well, Abraham has a grandson named Jacob, and Jacob has 12 sons. They become what we know as the 12 tribes of Israel. Well, one of those sons, we know the story of Joseph and the coat of many colors. Well, Joseph apparently mouths off a little bit too much about the dreams he's been having to his brothers, and they sell him into slavery, and he's sold into slavery, and he's taken to Egypt. And all of the story of Joseph is a man of great integrity. He just does what God tells him to do. He's thrown in prison unrighteously. He's sold into slavery for the wrong reason. You know, his whole life was this tapestry of bad fortune, but he was faithful. And what happens is, through all of his integrity, through all of his faithfulness, he comes to where he's number two in Egypt behind Pharaoh after he interprets one of Pharaoh's dreams. And he lets Pharaoh know there's a famine coming. So as number two, he's able to protect the whole world from this famine that's coming. And during the famine, when it happens, they're ready. They have stores of food. And guess what? His family back in Canaan, they say, "Hey, we're hungry. We got to go to Egypt to get food." And through a series of events, he's reunited with his family. And all of his family migrates to Egypt. And they're there. And they begin to prosper in Egypt. And just after a few years after Joseph dies and a new pharaoh's come to power, they begin to forget all about that nonsense. And they say, "These Israelites are too many of them. We need to put them in slavery." So they enslave them. Guess how many years? Just like God promised, for 400 years. Anybody watch the Ten Commandments on TV last night? We know that story. They're enslaved, and God says, "Don't worry, I'm going to bail them out of there." And he sends Moses, and Moses comes, and Moses doesn't want to come, but God makes him go, and so he goes, and he confronts Pharaoh, and Pharaoh won't let him go. And after all these plagues that God puts on the nation of Egypt, they finally said, "Okay, you can go." The last plague, the most horrific, was God said, "Okay, the death angel is going to walk through Egypt, and the firstborn of every family and of every livestock, the firstborn is going to die unless they have the blood of a sacrificed, unblemished lamb on their doorpost. If there's blood on the doorpost from an unblemished lamb, the death angel would just pass by. He would pass over their house." And that became the tradition in the Hebrew people of the Passover. Guess what meal Jesus was celebrating with the disciples the night of his arrest? The Passover. Before the blood of the Lamb covered the sin of all mankind. Not just a coincidence. So God delivers them out of Egypt. They walk out. The Egyptians are giving them stuff as they're going. "Here, go. Have fun. Enjoy. This is all my money." And they walked out prosperous. And they were directed into the wilderness. And Egypt pursued them, but they crossed the Red Sea. And you know that story. And they came into the wilderness, and God gave them the law. But there became this back and forth where the people were rescued and saved by God and provided for. But they kept disobeying. They kept saying, "We just need to go back to Egypt. It's too hard out here," because they were looking at their circumstances and stopped trusting the God that brought them. Finally, God had enough at a place called Kadesh Barnea. And they refused to listen to God say, "Go into the land." And he says, "All right, all you people 18 and over, you're going to die out here in the wilderness. The rest of you, I will take you into the Holy Land." And God gave them the law during this time. And they wandered in the wilderness for 40 years. But eventually, Moses dies, Joshua becomes his successor, and they go to the promised land. Starts with a miraculous crossing of the Jordan River, just like the Red Sea. It's split, they cross. The first city they come to is Jericho. Y'all know that story. The walls of Jericho fell, and it was the first city as the Israelites came in, and they conquered the Holy Land with a strategy, tactics that are actually taught in military schools all over the world today, because it was a brilliant military strategy that God told them to use. And so they did. They conquered the Holy Land. And it became theirs as a possession. And the land was divided up among the 12 tribes. and they each had their own parcel of land. And the same thing happened that always happened with Israel. Things would be good, and they would be praising God. And then they would start to look around at some of the pagan cultures around them. They would marry into those families and adopt those cultures and start to drift away from God, and God would judge them. And we have the period of the judges. And this cycle happened over and over again. People would rebel, and they would say, yeah, we don't need God, and they would do their own things, and they would sin against him, and he would rise up a nation, and the nation would give them trouble, and they'd say, help, God. And God would raise up a judge and fight back, and the people would praise God, it's all good, and it would go over and over. During the period of the judges, that's when we find out about Gideon and about Samson. The book of Ruth happened in there. But after all this time, the Israelites are thinking, wow, we want to be like these other nations. We need a king. We don't want to be 12 independent states or 11 independent tribes. We want a king. And so they go to the last judge, a prophet of Israel. They go to Samuel, and they say, we want a king. So Samuel does his job. He goes to God. He says, God, they want a king. And God says, they don't need a king. I'm their king. Go tell them. God says, he's your king. You don't need a king. Well, we want a king. They want a king. God says, okay, you're not going to like it. And so he says, all right. And God chooses Saul, the first king of Israel. And so Saul does okay for a little bit, but then he falls off and he's replaced by David. And you know the stories of David's life. He becomes the king, blood, guts, and all, through all of his failures and through all of his triumphs. And he has a son named Solomon, the wisest, wealthiest man of all time back then. And just built the temple, and Israel was finally looking like the nation on the planet, okay? Everything is going great. And in his older years, he starts to lose his wisdom because he starts to marry and bring in pagan wives, and they begin to influence him. And so he even drifted from God and began to disobey. And as a result, the nation was torn apart. You had the northern kingdom and the southern kingdom, the northern kingdom Israel and the southern kingdom Judah. And guess what happened? The northern kingdom, they never had a good king. They never followed God. And God judged them. He brought in the nation of Assyria, rose them up. They came in. They took over the northern kingdom. The southern kingdom, Judah, they were about half and half. They had some good kings that led them to the Lord, and they had a bunch that strayed. But eventually, God said, that's enough. And he rose up a nation called Babylon, and Babylon came in, and they took over all of the Assyrian properties, and then they conquered Judah. And when they did, they took all the Israelites out of Israel, out of Judah, out of Jerusalem, and they exiled them to Babylon and tried to assimilate them in their culture. And so the Jews were exiled, and they were living in a land that was not theirs again. They were basically enslaved and trying to be absorbed into a different culture. But God saved a remnant. Again, God had a plan. God sent prophets through the whole thing, kept trying to warn them, don't do this. Go back to the Lord. And even as they're in captivity, he continues to send prophets and tells them very accurately what's going to happen. And so finally, Persia comes to power. And Persia takes over all of Babylon's territory and all of the Holy Land. And as they do that, y'all may have known some of the stories about Persia and King Xerxes and Artaxerxes, but they begin to actually allow the Jewish people to return. And so the Jewish people return, and they go, and they rebuild the temple, and they rebuild the city, and they rebuild the walls. But the most important thing, they reestablish worship of Yahweh, and they become a central people again. Now, meanwhile, Persia, they get a little bit too big for their britches, and they begin to try to conquer, and they step up into Greece, and that don't really work out well for them. Well, they come back. Well, we enter into a period of silence. God stopped sending prophets. He said, I've told you all I'm going to tell you, but don't worry. Messiah's coming. So we have a world broken. We have people chosen, and now here the Israelites are. They're still kind of overtaken by other nations, but they're themselves again. And God sends these prophets, and he keeps telling them about the Savior that's promised. And as the Savior is promised, after all these, we talked about this last week, 380 scriptures that talked about who the Messiah was going to be. If God was going to show up, what would he look like? Sometimes very vivid details, where he was going to be born, some of the situations. God told them all these things about the Messiah. The problem is the Israelites looked at all these prophecies through these filtered lenses about what was their biggest problem in life. Their biggest problem in life was their occupiers. See, Greece took over everything, and when they did, they took Greek culture and Greek language everywhere. And now there was a common language. Well, then Rome rises to power, and guess what Rome does? They kind of stabilize this incredibly barbaric world, and they build roads everywhere. The perfect time for God to send a Messiah. Because now there are roads, it's safe to travel, and everybody can communicate. And after years of silence, God's going to send a Messiah. And it wasn't going to be the kind of Messiah people were expecting. I'm going to read. This is from the prophet Isaiah, chapter 53. It's well known. Messianic verses, it's called. Verses 1 through 6. Written 800 years before Jesus. It says, "Who has believed what he has heard from us? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, and no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. As one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions, and he was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all." When you hear that prophecy, 800 years before crucifixion was even a thing, it talks about the kind of death that Jesus was going to experience. And through this period of silence, God was just waiting for the perfect moment. And in the perfect moment, he sends an unexpected Messiah, an unexpected Savior, which brings us to the story of the New Testament, the story of Jesus. Now, the Old Testament is the Old Covenant, the covenant in the way that they operated and they interacted with God. The New Testament is a new covenant because the Messiah is here. And it's the story of that. And the story of Jesus, you know, he lived differently. He had some things that were normal like you and me, but his life was different. Just think about it. God was going to send his son to earth, you would expect him to be born in a palace. You would expect him to be a wealthy, rich, influential guy. No, that's not how it happened. You know the story of his birth. He came in such humble circumstances, born in a stable. The visitors were shepherds, lowly people in that class. And he grew up in this culture. He had to flee to Egypt and come back. And he lived probably, you know, we don't know a whole lot about his young years except for one little episode where he ditched his parents to go baffle a bunch of preachers at the temple. I love Mark Lowry brings up a good point. How would you like to grow up in that household? How would you like to be Jesus' little brother or sister? He had brothers and sisters, you know, James and Jude, who wrote New Testament books, you know. You come in with your report card, and Mary looks at James. Jesus got straight A's in science. James is like, of course he did. He wrote the book. James, why don't you act more like Jesus? I'd be like, Mom, why don't you act more like Jesus? But other than that, it's probably a normal childhood. You know, he had bad breath and he had BO when he got sweaty, you know. But he lived that there was always something different about him. And as an adult, he began his ministry. He began to tour and run around with these 12 hand-picked ragtag group of disciples. And if you were going to pick 12 disciples, we probably wouldn't pick the same people he did. A hated tax collector, a bunch of grimy fishermen, just ordinary people. He didn't look for superstars. He picked just very ordinary people. He began to go around and do miracles, all kinds of different miracles to validate that he was the Messiah. And his own, the Jewish people, rejected him for the most part. He lived differently. He was homeless for 3 years while he did his ministry. He taught differently. The way Jesus taught was just radical for his day and age. It's radical for our day and age. He cut right to the heart of the matter when he was getting into stuff. Okay, he taught the difference between righteousness and self-righteousness. Those things that we do that are they're good things that make us proud of ourselves. He wanted to get us away from those kind of things, and he raised the bar on so many things that had been taught. He said there's a difference between relationship with God and simply religion and ceremony. He said, you've heard it said don't murder, but I'm telling you, don't even hate people. You've heard it said don't commit adultery. I'm telling you, don't even lust. And he's raising the bar, and he's teaching in a powerful way, and he had full authority, and people just began to flock to him because he taught differently. He was teaching the opposite of his culture. He was going against everything that people were worshiping the rules and not the king. They were focusing on the rituals and not the ruler. They were emphasizing the ceremony over worship. They were trying to be accurate instead of loving. And Jesus cut right through the heart of all that. He taught differently. And then finally, he died differently. He died innocently at the hands of people he could have wiped out while asking for God to forgive them because they didn't know what they were doing. Just as predicted, he died between two thieves, a horrible death. But what we celebrate today is he didn't stay that way. That on the third day, he rose again. Now this is, like I say, this is the crux of human history. This is the dividing point for those who really know the Lord and those who do not. The crucifixion. And I know as we lose some people, I say, you know what? I can believe Jesus was a good teacher. I can believe that he was could even do some miracles. But rise from the dead. I've got a friend I've known for years. He said, I just can't get there. I just can't. I get it. It sounds like a fairy tale. But what do you do with the resurrection of Jesus Christ? Here's the linchpin of the story. They're honest questions, and I get it. But let's just look at the facts for one moment. Okay, Jesus, historically, was a real person. We don't just know about him from the Bible. There are all kind of external, non-biblical sources, some that are even antagonistic to the message of Jesus, that wrote that he actually lived, that he was crucified, and that he performed miracles, and he had a great following. Okay, he was a real person. Second, is not only lived, he died. There are some theories out there. Well, Jesus didn't really die on the cross. That, you know, he just fainted, and then they buried him accidentally, and then he woke up, and, you know. Yeah, he was crucified, nearly bleeding to death, stabbed in the side, and then he was put into a tomb with a stone rolled over there, and then he woke up and said, oh, I feel refreshed. And he tore off his garments that he was bound in, and he rolled this two-ton stone out of the way and walked out, and everything was fine. Don't buy that. Okay, he really died. He was crucified by expert Roman executioners. And to make sure he was dead, they had broken the legs of the two thieves. They stuck a spear in his side to make sure, and blood and water flowed. Go read the medical aspects of that. He was really dead. Another fact you need to get a hold of. This is a historical fact. The tomb was empty after 3 days. It's a fact. How do we know that? Here's the thing. These guys, the disciples, if they were going to go, they went out and preached the resurrection of Jesus immediately. They went out. These same guys that were scared, they went out and started preaching. Where were they preaching? In Jerusalem. Now, if I don't believe this, if I think this is a hoax and I'm in charge, if I have any control, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to go bring that body out and say, here, see, he's still dead. They didn't do that. The Jewish leaders didn't do that. The Romans didn't do that. They were frustrated because they knew, and it's recorded, the tomb was empty. And we try to dismiss that. Well, that's because the disciples stole the body. Yeah, they stole the body. These same guys that were cowards running away the night of his arrest, all of a sudden they muster up their courage. Now we're going to steal the body and form the biggest hoax on mankind's history. And we're going to be willing to die for this lie. That doesn't happen. There was an empty tomb. Now, does this prove that Jesus rose from the grave? No. It just means it's worth considering. There were the fact that women were the first eyewitnesses to the resurrection. Now, what does that mean? Well, women, their testimony in that culture weren't even allowed. Their testimony wasn't allowed in court. They were second-class citizens. But yet, these were the first people that Jesus revealed his resurrection to. If you're going to make that story up, you don't do it this way. Does that prove that he rose from the grave? No. But it makes it worth considering. To me, the most powerful thing about the resurrection of Jesus is the change you see in people's lives. You see these disciples who were cowards one minute, who were so disillusioned because they were still expecting this military conqueror, and they didn't realize this was a spiritual kingdom he was ushering in. And when he rose from the grave, their lives were changed radically. They went from being cowards to the bravest men on the planet. Each one of them died a martyr's death. They were beheaded. They were crucified. They were stoned to death. All these horrific things that were done to them. And not a one of them recanted. Every one of them was willing to die for what they believed. All they had to do was say, nope, I made up the whole thing. Their lives would have been spared. Not one of them. Every one of them, with the exception of John, who was exiled to Patmos. He didn't have an easy life. But all of them died that way, and not once did any of them say, nope, I was kidding. Nobody faces death for something they don't really believe in. You know, what was that change? You look at James, his own brother thought he was nuts. James did not believe that Jesus was the Messiah. And then all of a sudden, James has a turnaround. He sees his brother resurrected from the dead and becomes the leader of the Jerusalem church. Paul, his job was to round up Christians. His name was Saul, and his job was to round up Christians and persecute them and even put them to death. He was there when the first martyr, Stephen, was killed for his faith. His clothes were brought and laid at the feet of Saul of Tarsus. And then Paul has an encounter with Jesus, and his life is turned around, and he becomes a preacher to the Gentiles, the most famous preacher in the world's history. Goes all over the known world preaching the gospel that Jesus had been raised from the dead. Now, you look at all these guys, and you say, what changed? Here's what changed. I saw him dead, and I saw him alive again. Does that prove that Jesus rose from the grave? No. But it's starting to look like it, isn't it? You may have blocks and mental blocks about the story of Jesus, how it's been fabricated and all that. We're starting a study this week on Wednesday nights called The Case for Christ by Lee Strobel, where we address some of those things and help relieve some of our doubts. You will never prove that Jesus was who he said. You can't prove it, but you can. There's all kind of evidence to say you can come to a very logical conclusion that he is who he said he is. And we are who he says we are. So that's it. You got the story of God, you got the story of Jesus. Well, where are we now in the Bible? Well, right afterwards, Jesus rises, he begins the church. So what's the story of the church? In Acts chapter 1, we see Jesus' ascension after his resurrection. And he says this, beginning in verse 6. So when they had come together, they asked him, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? He said to them, it is not for you to know the times or seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and all Judea and Samaria and to the end of the earth. And when he had said these things, they were looking on. He was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. And while they were gazing into heaven as he went, behold, two men stood by them in white robes and said, Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking into heaven? This Jesus who was taken up from you into heaven will come the same way as you saw him go into heaven. He commissioned the church. And in Acts chapter 2, Peter gets up and he preaches a sermon about the whole story and talks about the resurrection, and 3,000 people come to know the Lord that day. The church was born. The church was commissioned, and it took off like wildfire under oppression. And it became this living, breathing thing. Even though everybody was trying to stamp it out, it just continued to grow because people began to believe in the resurrection. See, we get confused. The Bible has a lot of different stories, a lot of different metaphors about the church. You know, that it is a family. It is a flock of sheep. Paul's favorite was it's Christ's body, the bride of Christ. And all of these come to say a lot of things about it. But to really understand the church, I'll tell you what, if you're here, maybe you're a visitor this morning, or maybe you're not a church person and you don't get to go to church a lot, or you don't for whatever reason. You know what, just sit back and relax for a minute, because I'm going to talk to you church people for a minute. All right, first thing, the church is not a building. You've heard me say this time and time again. With all the biblical metaphors that they have in common, the one thing it never says is the church is a place you go to. It's a people that you are. You don't go to the body, okay? If you're part of a family, you don't go to the family. You're just a part of the family. That's what the church is. Especially early on, there was no concept of a physical church location. They met in houses. Were they any less the church? No. Because the concept of the church was a people. It was understood that in the first century, if you were a believer, you were inherently a part of the church. If you weren't a part of the church, then it was generally known that you weren't really a believer. Because to be part of the church means you're part of this group of individuals. When Christians substitute seeing themselves as the church and instead see the church as this building, we lose this fundamental piece of what it means to be a follower of Jesus. See, the church then becomes, when I separate myself from the church, it becomes something peripheral. It becomes something categorized in my life. It becomes something I go to. Therefore, I lose something about what it really is. There's me and there's the church, and nothing about that is biblical. And viewing the church this way, it converts what the church is supposed to be into this, like, spiritual vending machine, where I just go and it's just, I get my needs met, and I get my spiritual wants and my preferences. And that is not the intention of the church. It's not a building we go to and we get services, and it builds this consumerism in us. You know, a lot of people are disillusioned by the church today. Is there any wonder why? Because we don't get it anymore. Well, if the church is not a building, what is it? The church is a people. It is a people that love God and love others. It's a people that celebrate. It's a people that bless and serve those around them. A people that listen to those around them. It's also a people who know how to rest and work and play to the glory of God. You know, many of us understood when we were kids. Remember the old, here's the church, here's the steeple, open the door, and there's, I don't even know if I'm doing it right. But that's what we're taught when we're kids. And then I grew up and I started learning the scripture. I'm like, that's really not, man, we are so different here today than what they were then. What got mixed up when we institutionalized the church? We stopped being the church. And we messed it all up. When we gather, what's the church supposed to look like? If we are this body of believers that are just following Jesus, what should it look like? We've got our concept, we got our ideas, but biblically speaking, what should it look like? We had an interesting topic or discussion the other night in our men's Bible study. Somebody brought up, you know, why is it that I feel more comfortable walking into an AA meeting than I do walking into a church? That's a good question. When we come to church, all of a sudden we have to put our guard up. We start to, you know, okay, I got to look, you know, presentable to all these people in the church. Why? Why can't we be more like a recovery group? I told y'all, I went and visited. We went to a Celebrate Recovery worship service a couple of weeks ago. We're going to start a Celebrate Recovery group here in the fall. This is a blanket organization to deal with all the, their tagline is for people with hurts, habits, and hang-ups. That's all of us, right? We all have stuff we struggle with. All of us brought baggage through these doors. But to go into a recovery group, what happens in there? When you go in there, they bring their full awareness of themselves, all their sin, all their brokenness, and they get in and they just be real with one another. They're just going, I'm struggling. This is what's going good, but this is what's going bad. When they gather, they recite the very first step. I'm powerless on my own. I can't do this. I need help. I need a higher power. I need God to help me through this. They hear from one another, often like a good sermon. They receive challenges from one another. They commit to a total practice of reconciliation with other people. There's informality. There's this lack of hierarchy. They have encouraging accountability for one another. They insist on experiencing God. They focus on spirituality. When someone relapses or falls back and they show back up, people, they don't shoot their own wounded. They welcome them back in and say, we're going to help you through this. We still love you. You're still one of us. They share their own stories of brokenness without fear of rejection. And here's another thing. They have fun. They enjoy each other's company. And I refuse to believe that everyone in a recovery group is any bit less annoying than some of us in church are. They still gather and enjoy each other's company because they know gathering together, there's no pretense, there's no faking it. This is who I am, this is what I need, and this is the God that I'm walking toward. That's what the church should look like. That's who we're supposed to be. Are you with me? You wonder why people are leaving the church? It's because we're not being the church. I'm not talking about inside these walls. I'm talking about in our lives, when you go to work, when you go to school, when you're at a family reunion, whatever it is. You're to be the church. You're to be that representation that goes all the way back to when God chose Abraham. I want you to represent me. Tell these people how much I love them. Tell them how much I want to provide for them and give purpose and meaning to their life. That's the part of the story we're in right now, the story of the church. That's who we are and who we're supposed to be. All right, y'all ready for a test? Because now you have the whole story. That's the whole story of Scripture in about 30 minutes. What's the one thing that holds it all together? It's the resurrection. The resurrection of Jesus Christ is everything that the Old Testament, the Old Covenant, was building up towards. And now it's the one that we're living in, that we live and go through life with hope because of it. That we can face death with hope. That we can face life with purpose. Because church is not some part of my life. Jesus is my life. What's your part in that story? That's the real question. That's the story, but what's your story? We read the resurrection account that one of the most beautiful things about the scriptures is here's this collection of books written over 1,500 years by 40 different authors, 66 books. All tells one story that's seamless and flows and fits all together. Now, it's not chronological in your Bible, but it is one story, and it's beautiful. Now, I'm one of those people that likes to go and check the end of a book before I read the whole thing. Don't judge me. If I'm going to invest in reading a big, thick book, then I want to make sure that I'm not going to be ticked off or depressed at the end of it. I can get that from the news. But let's go. Let's look at the end of the book. Let's see how it finishes up. Revelation 21, second from the last chapter in all of Scripture, talking about what's in store. Beginning in verse 1, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man, and he will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away.'" That's the end of the book, that God wins, that we win. But do you see the beauty in this? We go all the way back to the beginning, how the story started. Perfect communion with God. It was all perfect. How does it end? Just like it started. God redeems and restores all that was busted and broken, and he wants to redeem and restore all that is busted and broken in your life. Now you know the story. The only question is, do you know the Savior? Do you know Jesus? I'm not asking if you know about him or know who he is or know the history. You can know all that stuff. Do you know him? Have you ever met him? And I mean met him on his terms and not yours. You talk to a lot of people what they believe about God. You peel away the layers. And quite often what you're only left with is, I believe this way because this is what I want to believe, because I don't want God telling me what to do. You can believe that all you want. It doesn't change God from being God and being the creator of the universe, the author of life, and the redeemer of your soul. And the beauty of this story is that he wants you. He wants you so bad he was willing to die for you in a horrible way. But in doing so, to rise again and to conquer death. And that is Resurrection Sunday. But do you know Jesus? Because if you don't, it's just another day where we eat lunch together and look for eggs. What a waste of what this day represents. We invite you, come to Jesus. He is real. He is a real God who really died for you and really wants a relationship with you. If you want to have that relationship with God, you've got a chance right now. We're going to have a time of what we call invitation or response. And we just invite you, if God's tugging at your heart, if he's making you feel, you know what, I'm separated from him. I'm just like Adam and Eve. There's this wall between us. You recognize that Jesus, when he died on the cross, it was the penalty for every bad thing you've ever done. And when he rose from the grave, he put his stamp on your life saying, you can have eternal life because I've conquered death. And you can have eternal life in heaven, but you can have purpose in life now. If you're here and you're one of those people that brought a bunch of baggage in these doors and you just want somebody to pray for you, this is your time too. We're going to have people lined up here at the front. I'm going to ask if a couple of our people, if you would, deacons or whoever, if you would stand at the back also, if somebody wants to go back and just be prayed for. But this time of response is just a time of worship, and I ask that you listen and feel God stirring your heart about whatever it is, and you respond. I'm going to pray for us. Would you stand with me? God, we thank you for what today means, the God that you are, and we just offer this time to you. I ask that you speak to every heart here. I know there are a lot of hearts that are hardened and just need to be softened, and there's a lot of hearts that are broken and need to be healed. We've got physical stuff. We've got relationship stuff. We've got financial stuff. Jesus, you died and rose again for all of that, but what you died and rose again was for our hearts to be yours. I pray anyone in here that hasn't done that, that they would give it to you today. Father, I ask that you move among us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
salvation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished.
Then came the morning that sealed the promise.
I know. Stand up, sit down. It's just Christian aerobics. What a great service as God speaks to those of us that have known him a long time or even a short time. A couple of announcements as we finish our service. It is Fifth Sunday, and Fifth Sunday we usually have World Hunger Offering in the pew in front of you. If you're wanting to give the World Hunger, you can put that in one of the envelopes, put it in one of the wooden receptacles on Fifth Sunday. We do that. Coming up pretty soon, we have our GA Luncheon. Details are on your bulletin, but they're wanting us to sign up so they make sure they have enough food for that day. It's not today, but it's coming. And also, just a quick preview, a service of prayer and praise. If you don't know this, there are three churches that meet on our overall campus: Hispanic Church, Abba's House, and here. We're going to have a mixed service all together praising his name. And it's going to be a great time. Details are there. Come be a part of that. It's going to be great to see what God does that morning as he always speaks to us as we come. I hope that you have a great Resurrection Sunday. God gives you somebody to tell this week about him. I've asked Nancy Carter. She's going to pray for us to end our service. Have a great Sunday together with family and friends.
Heavenly Father, how we thank you and praise you, Lord, for the hope that Jesus brought by his death, burial, and resurrection. Father, I pray that you will continue to do a work in us as we leave here. Father, that we will say yes to what you are calling us to do. We thank you, Father, for everyone that's here. And Lord, help us to go out and be your church. In Jesus' name.